So this is how then government is immoral. This organization that calls itself government then only knows how to solve problems through one way, a singular way, and that's through the threat of and use of violence versus the plurality of nonviolent solutions that us three here already share.
I see what you're saying.
Right. What do you think about that?
I don't know if I agree, because as the government, I mean, this is going to get tricky because, you know, somebody's going to say that they don't have their best interests, our best interests, which I would agree. Most of the time, it's selfish, they're greedy, they want more power, but the choices that are enforced by law enforcement, for example, like, let's just do something general, like speeding. If you are driving recklessly, you'll get pulled over. I think that not all, but most of the laws that they put in place are for protection of you, and even if you don't want that protection, it's for protection of others.
You would say that laws must be universal, though, right? If there are exceptions, it's not a law, it's a preference, right?
Yes.
Right. Otherwise, so you can look like the law that says theft is bad and wrong, right, and criminal, then that's what will be applied to everyone, regardless of what title or color costume you wear, right? So if theft is wrong, that's also universally applied to taxation because you never gave consent to that. There's no factual evidence to show of a contractual relationship with government, right? So let's break down what is government, right?
Okay.
Make it even more clear. Government has a monopoly on the services that you and I want. Because I want roads, I want law, right? I want rules, I want security, I want the post office, right? For example, USPS has a monopoly on first-class mail. It is illegal and criminal for FedEx, UPS, and DHL to compete in the market in delivering pieces of paper. They can only deliver packages. ABC, another great example here, right, in Virginia. They have a monopoly in distilled spirits. No one's allowed to compete with ABC. So that's all that government is, in which you don't have the economic freedom, though, to cancel or unsubscribe as you would from a real business or compete entrepreneurially in order to say, I can provide you a better service that's not going to be abusive or harmful to you, the consumer.
Right. So I actually took an ethics class, and we discussed this about monopolies and large corporations buying out smaller corporations, and is it wrong? Is it right? I think the good in me wants to say that it's wrong for larger corporations to buy out because everybody should have their own freedoms, their own liberties to, you know, express what they want in their own way. And whether that means you're like a smaller TV cable provider, internet provider, and you're not, you can't be in competition with like Time Warner Cable or something because they have the larger thing. I don't know, Spencer.
Well, I know exactly
finish,
where you're...
Finish my thoughts.
Yeah,
I would say, I mean, I think government's important because you do have to have these rules and regulations. Just for an economy to work and to work well, you need some body that has the control, that can control it. And whether they control it right all the time is up to question, but yet they do control it and help the economy to grow through it. And then also going back to your point of taxes, that you do want to give to the needy but not to fight wars. The only issue I see with that is if I was not like forced or obligated to pay taxes, would I? Or would I keep it all for myself? Because I think our first nature is obviously selfishness. And therefore, if I work for the money, if I make the money, I'm going to keep the money unless I'm having to pay out. And then, therefore, government is the best option and also the most.
But you cannot call it charity if it's forced, though, right?
I don't think taxes is really charity.
Right, it's not. Right. So it's not really helping anyone if I rob from you, right? That's not helping you. That's not helping the poor who are taxed, right? Because nearly half their income is already robbed through taxation. We add up local, city, federal, state, imports, tariffs, sales tax. Everything they buy has been taxed along the way, which costs increased cost of goods. Your money losing its depreciation of value, right? Since money itself has been monopolized in 1913 through the Federal Reserve, lost 97% of its value. Hurts the poor the worst with a tight budget to begin with, right? So taxes not just hurt you or robbing from you, it also robs from them from having a living wage. It's not McDonald's that's preventing them from having a living wage. It's government when you add up at the end of your paycheck, right? FICA, Social Security, all that stuff. Nearly half your income.
So let's just be basic again, how would we pay for roads? If, I mean, how many people would be like, yeah, sure, here's some money. Let me give you money for roads.
Sure.
Because then...
Have you ever read 1984?
No.
I'm not.
No? Okay.
I wanted to read that, though.
Yeah, it's a great book. So there's a scene in the book where, like, the future's kind of been revamped, like rewriting history, and people have forgotten how things were in the past. that's kind of what you're going to find in government schools as well. All these things the government has monopolized, at one point in the past, were privatized. And in the past, they would charge you when you were driving. The roads were built by private entrepreneurs, and they would charge you by the width of your axle. If it was too thin, you're creating ruts, so they charge you more. If it was too wide, they charge you less because they're evening out those grooves, right? But the thing is, today, government doesn't build roads. It's businesses that build them. They just steal your money and outsource them to the politically connected businesses to do them for you already. So right off the bat, government doesn't build roads. Businesses do. People will.
Well, they're enabling.
Yeah.
They're enabling.
They have the money and the resources that allow roads to be built. Because again,
but roads are not very complicated, right? It's a gravel, right? You look at the engine of a car, that's complicated, right? To create war roads, it's like, are you guys studying economics? So you were mentioning supply and demand earlier. What are you guys studying here?
Well, I'm an elementary education
major. Okay, okay.
I'm in
all
a school right
there.
Now.
Yeah.
And we're teaching the kids about economics.
Well, there we go. All right, so if there's a market demand for a product or service, there would be entrepreneurs to go out there to kind of meet that demand, right?
Right.
People want roads. Great, I'm in the market. I've been in the roads business, baking business for 10 years. Look at my customer feedback review, 5 stars out of 5 stars. We'll be out there to make sure all those potholes are filled every time. Guaranteed. Check us out first. We're better than the competitors, right? The government can't do that, which is why over here it's like driving on a moon, riddled with potholes all over the place, right?
I would agree with you that in different places, we don't go to school here.
Yeah.
We go to school at the University of Kentucky. So
we're
in the Appalachian area.
Okay.
And I took an Appalachian politics class, and we discussed how do you get the poor out of the situation that they're in?
Right.
Do you go with, infrastructure? Do you go with tourist attraction? Like, how do you get the money there? And also, how do you bring the people to understand the value of education and of jobs and careers and the market and stuff like that? And that's kind of what this is, because the government in the Appalachian area, they're trying to figure out the same thing. And I think that's the thing, is it's the government who's trying. There are, charitable organizations or churches or things who are trying to help out with the cause of, let's get the poor out of the area that they're in, let's build them back up. But ultimately, it's just the way it's been set up. And honestly, I don't feel like I'm being stolen from, even though they take my taxes. I just see, they are going to be looking at the majority of what's going on in our country, and they're going to decide what is best for our country to succeed. And honestly, I don't think our country is super great or anything. I wouldn't say that, in the words of Donald Trump, we're going to make America great again or anything.
I mean, taxation is being robbed is never great, right? You may not feel it though, but what happens if you stop surrendering your property? They will throw you into a cage and come after you, right? This is what happens to people all the time, like a guy who paid off his home in D.C., retired. He forgot he didn't pay $152 in property tax, so the D.C. government put a lien in his house, foreclosed it, and threw him off on the streets, right? We're talking about how government helps the poor. The government creates nothing but impoverishment. If you look in the past between Lyndon Johnson's Great War on Poverty, poverty rate points were declining rapidly, almost nothing. Rome has succeeded in rising everyone out of impoverishment. And that was because there was all these mutual aid societies that were coming together. They're called friendly societies. So if there's anything you remember, when you walk away, just Google friendly societies. And you look at the way all these communities came together and voluntarily found ways to provide mutual aid for people who are unemployed. They had unemployment insurance, health insurance. They had all these awesome ways to help each other to get out of these ruts and go back to being happy and productive. But that was the last thing the government wanted, for these communities to be independent. Because the thing that the government needs for them to survive is to have people be dependent on government. So they got rid of all these things. And you had your Social Security, and you had your welfare system, your Medicare. Whereas before, it was provided voluntarily in the market, nearly eradicated poverty. And now today, you have nothing but an increase of poverty since then. Because if it's not in government's best interest to get rid of something, that'll throw them out of a job, right? So I would say that, even going back, robbing from people is not a great way to help them get out of poverty.
I would agree, but the government also has housing situations for the homeless. They have shelters for the homeless, and I understand that there are a lot of political things going on with homeless shelters and the Salvation Army closing down their meal servings and things like that.
They made the guy in D.C. homeless because he didn't pay his property tax.
However, I also find that you can find exceptions in anything. And so while that is clearly wrong, when you bring it out to like the whole population, that is rarely, if ever, the case. I mean, obviously you can find specific individuals.
What do you mean rarely is ever the case that taxation, robbing from someone, does not help someone?
But with the
robbing,
also known as taxation, you do get that vote. You get to vote in the politicians that make laws for you. And while you may say that they work against your interests,
but you don't give... Go ahead, sorry.
Then you should probably vote someone else in so that they will work in your interest. And if you think more money should go to poverty, to fighting poverty rather than war, you vote someone in that wants to fight for poverty.
So you're saying that someone who robs from me, I should choose which robber is going to decide to rob less from me and own my own best interest?
Yeah, well, if you see taxation as robbing, which you do.
Do you not?
I don't.
What happens if you don't give up? Well, can you do this? Can you stop paying your taxes? What do you think happens if you stop paying your taxes?
Right, you would get in trouble.
You would get, what do you mean getting in trouble?
Well, I mean, you stated it before about...
They will threaten you at gunpoint and throw you to a cage, right?
They don't threaten you at gunpoint. I mean, you do have to pay
it happens
the tax
to somebody. Yeah, what happens if you don't pay the taxes to IRS? What happens to that?
They'll
jail, which means if you resist, they'll point a gun at you. Try to run away, they'll murder you.
There has to be punishment for your decisions and for what you do. And then also...
But show me your contractual relation where you gave consent to government.
Yes, but when you're choosing to run away, I mean, you have to give someone power so that you don't have just chaos. And so we have the police that keep order. I mean, I firmly believe
that the millions of people suffering these cages for victimless crimes is order? You don't think that's chaos? You don't think millions of people, over 30 million people murdered since this 20th century alone by the United States government, that's order? You don't think that's chaos? The families and children being drone bombed out of existence overseas by Obama, you think that's order?
But there are also the people that are killing others. I mean, killing many more people than America.
Well, we are trying to get them out in the same time. But you think that today that's order here? You don't think that's chaotic? Where people can throw you into a cage for a victimless crime today in this society and tell you what you can and cannot do with your body and violate your consent, you think that's order?
What would you consider a victimless crime?
Saying taxes, not paying taxes, since that's like the main...
Well, a lot of things. A victimless crime, like if I want to smoke a plant. It's my body. I should be able to decide what I can and cannot do with my own body.
However, it does affect other people.
It
affects your decision-making, which therefore affects other people. Because
How does me and my own privacy, smoking a plant, affect you, who lives across the river or in Kentucky?
If you decide to drive and you have been smoking weed, which we know, like, there are mental effects on smoking weed. Am I right?
So if I decide to drive on government roads...
Wait, no, you made us answer the question. So do you have a mental effect when you... When you smoke weed. I've smoked weed. I understand
that. And that's a must that I have a mental effect when I drink coffee and caffeine, right? These are chemicals and different drugs.
That is true. Sure. And yeah. which both affect your decision-making, right?
I wouldn't say effect of improve.
But does it affect your decision-making? Like, in general?
I don't know if you would call it effect. I mean, everything affects my decision-making. The humidity, right? Makes me kind of tired. Right?
But your mental, I see where you're going.
A lot of things affect my decision making, not just caffeine. A lot of other numbers or factors are contribute to that, right?
So
I cannot solely square it away on one particular area.
You know what? And I would even agree that if the government is going to make weed illegal, they should make cigarettes illegal and alcohol illegal.
Why?
Because, no, I'm saying ultimately, if you're going to have the view that, like, if you want to have freedom with your body, why are they going to only make weed illegal.
Right, and so you universalize it, right?
Yeah. Right, so you have to either
alcohol.
Go all or nothing.
Right.
Which the government isn't doing, and I would agree that that's something that they would need to fix themselves, but I'm saying if we're going to all go with the idea that, you know, driving drunk is a crime, you get put in jail for driving drunk because you can kill someone.
Right, but I would say then, people who are sober kill a lot more people than people who are drunk. So why don't we outlaw sober driving then? Because if you look at the numbers of murders that do occur because of people who are sober, then let's blame them.
But you're not giving it.
No. We have to universalize it, right? People who are sober kill a lot more people than people who are drunk. So let us make it criminal for people to drive soberly.
You see that number, but then when you actually bring it out into percentages, the amount of people that are sober that kill someone is much, much, much lower.
No, wrong.
But
wrong.
It's such a small population.
No, it's not a small population. It is a number. All the car crashes that occur, over 300,000 people are killed on these roads because of government roads. right? If you went on a roller coaster, you wouldn't blame me trying to hold this wheel. You'd blame the roller coaster agency that built the tracks, right? These are government roads that should be held responsible because they're building these facilities, this infrastructure, right? That support the standard.
But we have control. In a roller coaster, you don't really have control over where it's going. You
or a bumper cart, you know, you're in the areas in which you're driving the car, right? The government controls the roads. They also control the types of technology that's allowed on those roads. It's kind of like we're driving in the passenger compared to everything else that kind of, you know, goes up by an upgrade, like computers, right? Old engines that we're still driving from decades ago. Doesn't improve, because if you have a monopoly on roads like the government does, you also control the type of fuel, you also control the type of vehicles and the technology that's permitted. And so, yeah, it holds us all back in terms of improving and upgrading towards a better place and how we could manage how to facilitate transportation.
You know, I would agree with you that there are a lot of things that the government does that is not in our best interest. I would say that that's
true. What do you think they do that is in our best interest?
Well, for example, they have control over, like, if we're going with police officers or the fire department.
Police officers is a good one. So, did you know, so there's many Supreme Court rulings, many Supreme Court cases, like Winnebago versus Deschene County, have ruled that the police, the government, have no obligation to protect your life, liberty, or property. Does not exist. There's no but. You're forced to give up your property, surrender it through theft, for something that they will not, they don't provide. There is no protection.
You don't feel that you're protected by the police?
Well, it's different between feeling and facts have shown that there is no protection, right? But the police, though, necessarily have to rob you of your private property through taxation in order to make the lying claim that we're here to protect you.
Well, if we're going to be universalists, the police aren't robbing you. It's the government, and the police are just acting on what they're supposed to do, what their job is.
Right, they send their extortion agents to come and collect, right?
So
they kick down the door.
The police officers themselves are not saying, as a group, they're not collectively being like, hey, they didn't pay their taxes.
Well, they have choices. Out. They could quit. They don't have to do in this
but
stuff,
that's
right?
That's not their job.
Well, when they swear to uphold all laws, they will throw you into a cage for a victimless crime.
What's your
and
job?
For what my you, job? What
yeah,
I do?
What's your career?
I do a lot of trading on the market.
Okay. So if you have certain things you have to uphold with that job, right? Or else either you will not
my reputation?
Money.
Yeah.
Right. Okay, that's the same with them, don't you agree?
No, because they have to hurt you first in order to tell you I'm here to protect you.
Well, I've never been hurt by the police. I know some people would argue that
do
they
you
have.
Pull over on the side of the road when the lights are turned on because, hey, this guy is just probably going to tell me there's something wrong with my lights? Or do you pull over because, you know, if you don't, they will chase you down and shoot you?
I don't feel like I'll be
I
shot.
I pull over because I know that I did something wrong. And
respect, also.
Therefore, I am accepting the punishment. Yes, I sped. I knew that was against the law, and yet I went beyond it. If you know what the law is, if you know what your obligation is, and then you cross that line, then, I mean...
But you never gave consent to those laws.
You're an American citizen. You gave consent.
There's there's no citizenship. Because if there is no obligation to protect you, citizenship is defined as political allegiance to a political body. In return, you'll be granted protection. Supreme Court judges and the government have said there is no protection, thus there is no political allegiance, thus there is no such thing as citizenship. It does not exist.
So what do you consider to be an American citizen?
Are no American citizens. We are tax slaves.
Tax slaves.
Virginia is a tax farm in which they will rob you of your happiness and productivity to cater to the people who do not work for a living and produce any productive value. Those are your politicians. Those are your police. These are not consumer-driven organizations. Chesterfield, many of these cops, they're not consumer-driven. If they were, they would rate their measure of success by, hey, the number of subscriptions. Look at the great review ratings that we've had, not the number of people we throw into cages to meet their quotas and because they can't work any other way. They're not a real business. A real business of security will give you a contract. We'll give you our obligations. We've been in the business for 20 years. We've never had to shoot anyone. We'll retain anyone. We'll protect you and your family and your community. And there are people who do that, right? Look at Detroit. You know what happened with government in Detroit, right? It's collapsed. All these monopolies become too much to pay and too costly. These unfunded liabilities and all these government services collapse. It takes over an hour for police to respond to 911 calls. But in Detroit, there's a private person who created his own business and providing protection security for all these communities. He stopped all the hijacking of trucks, and because of that extra profit, he's able now to lower the cost and provide a lot more security to the areas and the neighborhoods that police can never do.
Okay, so the first thing I would say is, as I've been listening,
yes,
is we could have a lot better educated of a conversation if, because you're very well spoken on this, you know your facts, you know exactly like the history behind things. We, as college students, we haven't really read into that, you know?
Yeah.
So you kind of have the upper hand here, am I right? By knowing all these things that we apparently don't know.
Well, if there are things I don't know, I don't presume to know, and I would just be kind of curious to say, yeah, I'd love to see some of these facts, right, and sources, right?
So, with that being said, you know, we kind of sit here thinking about all the things that we do know, and you're well-versed in this compared to us, which we are not as well-versed. And it's like we're being thrown around in circles. Like, I almost feel, don't take offense to this, I almost feel as if you're kind of just, like, putting us on this, you know, merry-go-round and making us go around and around and around so we can't, like, figure out what exactly we're thinking.
Right. We start off with the very basis, trying to show how government is immoral, right? Mm-hmm. And you already agreed from the very beginning that it's wrong and immoral to violently force your ideas onto other people. Right? And I showed through the example that government does nothing but that. You said it was wrong and immoral. You guys don't initiate force,
right? We didn't agree with that, though.
You didn't agree with that.
We didn't agree with that government was doing the immoral acts that asked us. Yes, what you said was immoral. However, we view government differently. We don't view it as robbing. We don't view them as taking our liberties.
Define robbing, then. What is your definition of theft?
Theft. Taking money illegally.
Not illegally. Yeah. Taking money illegally. What do you mean by illegally?
Okay, so the government can take your money.
You don't think
fraud is illegal?
I'm not talking about types of theft. If I were to take your backpack without your consent, right? Take your property. Would you not define that as theft?
It is, but you don't have authority over us in that way. You weren't granted authority by pledging your life to, say, the police. Like, you didn't say, yes, I'll be a police officer. Yes, I will uphold these laws that our country is founded on that we believe are protecting the majority of people. It's like our country is either universalist or not.
So if I wear a blue costume, then I could take your backpack from you.
Absolutely,
and that'll be okay.
Not.
Why not? No, because the blue costume is what gives them authority, right?
No, it's their sworn-in job and their badge saying that they have gone through the training course.
Okay, I could get a piece of paper and write down, I went to training, and get a badge and a blue costume, and now it's okay for me to
and
take from
you.
And
they still can't take it for anything. I mean, warrants have to happen. There has to be...
All right, so I get my friends who work with the same system, right? My brother who works in the same government, right? We all work for the same guy to write a piece of paper for me. Then it's okay now to take from you.
You're saying that the majority of...
So as long as I wear a blue costume and call myself a title...
As long as you have just reason, following why.
There's no
reason
just...
Reason in good faith.
Or suspect. Just suspect. Then yes, I should give it to you. However,
you should give it to me? A stranger that you've never met... You should hand over your property to them because they demand it. And
the government, I would not call a stranger. I mean, they do.
You don't know
the
these
rules.
People.
I don't know the people.
Yeah.
However,
them.
I still trust that they are my best interest because I see the order that they create, which obviously you think is chaos.
Right, let's go back to the definition of theft then, right? So if I were to take your backpack right now, right, you would not want me to do that, right? You would say, well, that violates my consent of my ownership of my backpack, right?
Correct.
Now... Because of that, now you're saying there's a different thing that occurs when government takes your backpack without your consent? And how is that not theft?
Because I pay taxes, I am a citizen, I live under this government, I trust this government to protect me, and therefore, when they take my backpack, I hope that it's in my best interest. While it may not seem like it at the time, when I look at the overarching scheme,
I find that it helps you know what, maybe if you wanna surrender your backpack, right?
Okay.
That's fine. What about other people who do not want to surrender the property?
Then they shouldn't call themselves an American citizen. They shouldn't live here. It's
Your
choice by moving here, by living here, is to say, I will live under these laws.
There's no factual evidence, none, to show me of a contractual relationship with these laws. Does not exist.
You will be deported if you are not a U.S. citizen and you stay here longer than your visa. Am I correct?
There's no factual evidence. None. Doesn't exist.
What do you mean factual evidence?
Factual evidence to show me of a contractual relationship that you've given this explicit consent, this consideration of this agreement with government and the laws and the monopolies that they have, including security and law and everything else. Doesn't exist.
We find that it's a privilege. I think it was set up to be a privilege, and therefore we are granted it with birth in the U.S. by an American.
Not a contract.
Okay, it's not a contract. However, if you disagree so much with the contract... Why would you not move to a country where there was no contract?
Why don't those who advocate violating my consent to rob me move out of here? Civilization belongs to the civilized, not to the barbarians. If you love being told what to do, you love government so much, it should be you that moves out of the country and go to North Korea, right? They have a republic. They have a constitution.
They don't have
a republic. Yes, they do. They sit on a piece of paper. These people of authority have also costumes and titles. How's that not any more illegitimate than the people here?
There's a lot more freedom here, for one thing.
What do you mean freedom here? You don't have any freedom. About the freedom
no
to
freedom.
To believe in the illusion that you are free is the only freedom that you have. If you cannot dictate and tell what you can and cannot do with your own body without strangers telling you otherwise and threatening to throw you to a cage if you disagree with their opinion, that's not freedom. That's slavery. That's prison.
It's for the public good.
There's a public good. It's not for my good. My good for you, not having self-ownership, does not provide me any kind of good.
I don't believe government is always right. I mean, smaller government is probably better government.
It still functions. The government started off with the smaller government. 1776 was the smallest government the world could ever kind of conceive, right? And look where we are today. A small piece of cancer tumor would grow up larger and larger and larger. You kind of leave it intact, right?
Sure.
The smallest city-state of Rome turned into an empire, right? And that's what we have today. And since then, millions and tens of millions have been murdered by this United States government that started off so very small because it started off with small little exceptions to violence, like taxes, 1%, then 2%, then 3%, and continues now to nearly half your income being robbed.
Which our country has grown since then. If you're looking at population numbers in regards to taxes, our population has grown, and then the incomes that we make like with our careers, those have grown. You're saying... In this point, it's almost like money is relative. Whatever, you know, if the dollar is worth a dollar or if the dollar is basically worth 50 cents. You know what I'm saying? Like
no, it was taxes were wrong back then as it is right now. 1% of theft, is this is wrong, it's 50% is theft.
So then how are we going to be run by somebody who...
You do not get run by anyone. That's the point I'm trying to say. All right, so the point of all this is...
For overall, no government at all.
Exactly, so, that's the point. Right, right. Which, so there's no limited government, there's no political rulers, no politician telling... What I'm advocating is... the abolishment of these monopolies and then replace for a free society based on consent that the market and people can compete to provide these goods services like contractually.
What is an example of this? And for one thing, let's talk about national parks because no person's going to pay for the national parks. And yet they do preserve what's great in a country. They do preserve nature, which is part of what makes a country, I mean, ours.
So national parks is a good one. You can look at the areas in which... areas that was not privatized, right? When the government was out there with these trains and whatnot and settling out west with these agencies, what ended up happening because these lands were not privatized, nearly the bison went extinct, right?
Yes.
It was because in private hands, on private lands that they brought them there, that they were saved from the brink of extinction. So much today that their population bounced back that now we can enjoy bison burgers, right?
Sure.
So areas in land conservation, I guess, if you want to protect the land and the environment, then privatizing it is the best thing you can do, then leaving it in the hands of a government that does not care or value human life. What makes you think if they don't care about the human life that they will rob you and throw you to a cage for a victimless crime for a plant from nature, that they will care for the environment?
You keep coming back to the plant, man.
It is.
But it's bad for you. It's bad for us.
Cannabis is bad. There's no factual evidence to show scientifically cannabis causing any kind of negative health
in
your
smoke.
Body.
In your body. I mean, that. How can that be good?
No factual evidence. None.
Okay. I mean, honestly, haven't seen it.
Yeah.
But it's still not good for me.
No, that's fine. So what ends up happening when you abolish government, like Virginia is a monopolized community, right? So the majority of preferences is forced onto the minority. When you abolish that monopoly, you have thousands of free societies catering to your preferences and lifestyle. Now we can have in a community that's 420 friendly, one across the river that's not. My rules and preferences will not extend, of course, across the river into your living room, right? Now we have rules that we agree to. Now we have explicit contracts to these sort of stuff.
But who makes the rules and who
upholds
those?
You do. Anyway. So, like, you can look at private golf course communities. Here's the rules of the community. Hey, anyone can have fun with golf during the hours of 6 to 6 p.m., right? In Florida, hey, this community, we want 65 and older seniors, right? You have a lot of different preferences. So
what happens when you don't follow those rules, then?
All right, the consequences are outlined in the contract. Right, look at the contract of all these different offers to live in this awesome society of people that I love to live with, and say if I break this rule, it could be a fine, it could be a Pella fight, it could be the Amish. The only rule they have you break one of the rules is this social ostracism. There's no fine or stockade or punishment or anything like that, right? So it's whatever is outlined in that contract, but you decide as a consumer, right?
You decide to say yes, I'll abide by this contract.
Right,
you're
right.
Right now we don't have that.
Right.
So if I say I don't want anyone on my private property, it's mine.
Yeah.
Mine.
Yes.
All right. And then someone comes on my private property.
Trespassing.
Do I have the right to do whatever?
Well, and communities will have like the agreements to the consequences of violation.
But I won't agree. It'll be my own.
Oh yeah. So like, if you live in the middle, if you live like in the middle of the woods somewhere off your own outside of these societies, yeah. I mean that's. People, everyone would agree that it's wrong and immoral to initiate force, right?
Yeah.
The initiation of force of violating your consent and trespassing on your property.
That's wrong.
Right, yeah, yeah. So some of these are, you would be justified in defending yourself from that violation of your consent.
So if I buy a piece of land, say, just a house down that way somewhere.
Yeah.
And then someone comes on my land some night, even if they don't know what they're doing, do I have the right to imprison them? Just because? I mean, because I have no contractual obligation to do anything different to them. I mean, we have rules set in place so that doesn't happen. So
well, people are thrown in imprisonment for all kinds of stuff they never gave consent to or agreed to.
Okay,
walking
yeah.
around, right? Even on public land, right? That we're not allowed to homestead. So, a lot of the stuff, the people will assume the risk when you move outside of these communities that there will be crazy weirdos out there, right? Who do not kind of...
That's scary.
That is kind of scary. So it's kind of best to have contractual relationship with communities that have established security and law and all this sort of good stuff, right?
Which you would say is not the government, which we're
right.
saying is the government.
Right here today, you don't have law, right? Laws have to be universal. If they don't apply to them, they're called criminal rules, prison rules that apply only to us and not the politicians, right?
Okay.
And you also don't have protection, right? This is your Mad Max Thunderworld scenario here.
I haven't seen that movie.
Me either. So that kind of...
Apparently it's a great movie, though. A lot of Oscars.
Right. So when people talk about, think about post-apocalypse, no security, no law. That's what you have today. There is no security. There is no law. This is preferences, forced and backed by gunpoint.
We disagree with that statement.
Well, factual evidence is shown otherwise, even by Supreme Court judges. So you may disagree, but the cases have overruled...
Yeah.
Disagreements of opinions.
Right.
And that's something fun to kind of look into, like, later, right?
Fun.
Like
I enjoy this. I enjoy yeah. all the time.
Like, afterwards, I want to exchange some messages. I'll send you all this stuff so you guys can kind of pick up and look into it for yourself and draw to, like, a better conclusion of that. But yeah, that's the direction that we want to go, right? If we want to go to a better place, we have to start off with fundamental principles that we agree with, right? We agree that it's wrong and immoral to violate consent, right?
So would you say that, I mean, if you're talking about, this is a little, like... veered away, but if you're talking about going to a better place and you say you don't want to leave here, right?
Yeah.
Because you live here.
Yeah.
And there are people who disagree with you, so they should leave, correct?
People who advocate for violating consent should leave, yes.
Okay, so my question that kind of like overrules, not overrules, but like is an umbrella over all of this is, do you believe in a higher power?
In a higher power?
Yes, other than yourself, do you believe in a higher power?
Are you talking like God?
God, your intuition, you know, any like, do you think that you're just here and then you're here and you're the God of yourself, so to speak? And then,
you
make your own
rules. Do you find
yourself
the highest and therefore you make your rules? Which
yeah, that's
will,
a better way.
Okay, like the only person who has any say of authority of my decisions is myself. Yes.
Right. Okay. Which I would say that's just free will in itself. We have free will, all of us. But... aside from that, do you believe that, you know, you have good morals? You're saying, like, if somebody is, you know, violating you, you believe that they're in the wrong. And that's a good moral to have. But where did those come from? If you're not governed by anything, if you're not agreeing with the government as itself, like, where do you come up with these morals?
Right. So that's a very good question, and that's why it's kind of good to ask, right? So, like, before we started this conversation, I started off asking what you consider to be wrong and immoral,
yeah,
right?
But where
and
do then, we get that?
Where do we get that? That's a good question. I guess so you could say, in terms of logic and reasoning, you can kind of come to some sort of conclusion like that.
You're taught logic and reasoning in school.
No, I was not taught that in school.
Okay, where are you taught logic and reasoning? Nature, maybe?
I guess confrontations with people and talking with them. And
but imagine you confronted someone.
Yeah.
And imagine that you're not you. You're somebody else who's agreeing with violence and saying that I get to take what I want from you. That's, to them, that's their moral reasoning, saying, like, this is how I grew up. This is how I viewed the world as I was growing up. These are the moral standings that I believe on.
Right.
Like, where did they get those versus where did you get yours?
And how are we right to say that they are wrong in their views?
Right, you just asked, right. So these are good questions. So that's why the very best way to find out, right, instead of assuming or generalizing, is to ask him, do you consider it wrong and immoral to initiate force, right? Do you consider it wrong and immoral to violently force your ideas onto other people? We can further define these terms as well. And majority of the people I've talked to here in the past 3 years, closing to four, agree. Nearly 1,000 people here. The tiny few who just have disagreed just happen to be communists. So yeah, they could be saying that it is morally permissible for me to hurt other people, All right, well, that's good to know, right? We kind of need to know who the violent sociopaths are in our community and whatnot, but at least they could universalize it, that it's always good to violate someone's consent. I will find that to be in the minority of sense of people who would disagree otherwise, but at least we can separate ourselves from those who advocate consent to be a highest virtue in our relationships that should be voluntary versus those who do not, right?
Which I'm like, I really understand what you're saying with this. Like, I get that, but I still don't understand where you're getting your moral reasonings, where we're getting our moral reasonings.
And I also think
okay, well, we'll say like respect for private property, right? So let's break it all down to respect for private property. How do we come to ownership of property?
You buy it.
Right. Buy it. So contract. Voluntary exchange, contracts, right? Title exchange of contracts. Another way would be
regulated by government as well.
Well, a government has to violate that voluntary exchange by robbing you of your property, and so they have nothing to do with that. So homesteading, right? Homesteading unowned resources, right? So the only in terms of resolving these conflicts of dispute that people have over property, they're solved in two ways: homesteading unowned resources or voluntary exchange of goods, right? And that's the only way to have property. What other way could you acquire property than those two justifiable ways? Some people will say stealing, right? But we would denote that as violating consent, right? Some will say murdering and taking over your land. We will consider that a violation of consent.
I guess I'm still just not understanding.
Well, I'm trying to tie in that some of these ethics can be tied in and
to
property rights. Yeah.
Well,
because so the reason why we need property rights is because resources are not infinite. If they were infinite, we'd have no problems with one another. You'll never have fights because we have enough resources in the world for one another. There would never be any conflicts or needing to interfere with one another.
One thought about this is like poverty. How would the impoverished help themselves in that society, in a society with no government?
All right, so like we mentioned earlier about corporations, right, and how they buy out small ones. Without government, there are no such thing as a corporation. All a corporation is a piece of paper backed and enforced by government that allows CEOs to escape liability for their own actions. The same immunity that makes it difficult to sue state prosecutors and judges and politicians because they have that immunity. So the immunity granted from them that allows them to escape liability and thus to amass a lot of mistakes in a short amount of time, right? So without government, no corporations, which means no more laws that limit competing people trying to enter that market, right? That prevents business competition. So now you have permits and licenses, for example, discriminate against the educated poor from competing. So removing all these barriers of entry, of restrictions of what one can do with their own property, liberates them financially, economically, towards achieving some sense of a way of making a living, right? Removing taxation, you know, half their income no longer being robbed and stolen from. I've talked to a lot of minimum wage people at these rallies here in Richmond, and they've never heard of that, and they come to the agreement. Yes, it's not McDonald's or this corporation that's stopping me. It's government that's stopping me from having a living wage.
Well, so, because they tax them.
Right, yeah.
They do sales tax, but however, when like income tax, typically with minimum wage, they get almost all their income tax back.
Right, but that's withholding tax. But so I will rob from you until for one whole year, and it's up to you to decide whether to rob too much or too little.
But then it comes back.
But it doesn't matter. So if I took your wallet, hey, don't worry, you're gonna get it back at the end of the year. It's like, no, give me back my wallet because I need that money. I'm on a tight budget to begin with. I'm poor, remember? You can't tell me how much I don't need that much money.
Why don't you use it from the year before and just make that whole?
The thing is, you can't really decide other people's opportunity costs, what they need for that money for, right? Because you don't know if they need that badly to pay for a ridiculous fee or whatnot.
But
that
if you get it in a lump sum, don't spend it immediately. Use that money that you got from the year before to cover this year, and then the year when you get back in the year.
Don't presume that they don't know what to do with their own money or how they should save or whatnot, right? If you don't know how to save your own money, then talk to, we're in economics, right? Talk to a financial advisor, right? Don't say, well, on your own good, we're going to take from you and give it to you at the end of the year.
Oh, I'm not saying it's for our own good. I'm just saying I think it's necessary.
Yeah, you can have like other areas of like interest rates, investments, right? You know, 1 year, you don't get any interest when the government takes your money, right? It's loan free, interest free, right? If we want to help the poor, that's the best way to do it. But at the same time, when we always ask, what about the poor? And everyone always asks that question, implies that we care about the poor. What about when government's abolished? There will be a lot of people asking that question. There will be a lot of organizations and a lot of charity groups, churches, and so much in abundance now, because now they're no longer restricted from the market to enter, and now nearly half their income is no longer being stolen. They can help more efficiently to finally bring them out of the poor like they did before in 1960s.
And I honestly do. I probably agree with you more than it sounds. I mean, I do agree with the smaller government. less tax because it is getting
heavy,
very heavy. I do still think the government is probably the best way that we have right now. I don't know that no government is the best way. And ultimately, I guess the main difference is that it probably goes to that we believe, I guess, in the higher power, and that we do give authority to something else, and we don't create authority all by contractual obligations, like that we do have that.
Or by our emotions.
We do have our code of living, and we have to live by that code. So that's already our contractual obligation.
Which we don't always live up to.
Which we don't always live up to.
What do you mean a higher authority? You talk about God?
Yeah.
So,
okay, yeah, that's perfectly fine. Yeah, like the Amish, you're asking for an example. The Amish do not force their laws into children because they know babies cannot give consent, right?
Correct.
Here on the government, you're forced as a collateral to fund Social Security. You're forced to be beholden into that program. You never gave consent to that. But the Amish know that babies cannot give consent to any kind of programs or laws, so they wait until they're of age and they say, well, here's the rules, and if you like it, you can agree to it.
You have a driver's license, though, right?
What does that have to do with anything?
Okay, like, you agreed to the government's road conditions.
That's not a contract, though.
I mean, you got that driver's license.
That's not a contract. A contract, elements of a contract include consideration. There are other opportunities you can kind of have a contract to, right?
You could have built a private road. You could have paid for a private road, but nobody
owns the road. Well, okay. The reason I would pay for a license is because if I'm driving on this road that nobody owns, some people in blue costumes might try to stop me with their guns, and I don't want to be murdered because they're going to say, where's your plastic? And I would say, I don't have one, and then they'll throw me to a cage.
Well, then why should you be driving on the government roads if you don't have the piece of plastic given by them?
Well, nobody owns the roads. It's not a government road. Who's the ownership of the road?
The government.
The government paid for it. They provided the money.
A government is a fictional entity. Fictional entities cannot own property, right? It's unowned land. Nobody technically owns it.
It is.
It's not.
Well, it's not owned.
Name one person. Name the person. Name the name.
Okay, but if they didn't do the roads...
Businesses made the roads. Yeah.
A business. It would be privatized.
Yes.
And therefore, you would have to pay for it, or you wouldn't get it.
Right, so if a business can build a road, which would be great, that'd be different. So now you can have different awesome road systems. You might have cars that drive by themselves at that time, because the monopoly technology is removed.
Really cool.
Right. And so businesses building roads will have their own rules, right? And I can, and with the contract stated, it's like, you know what, this is tolerable, yeah, I signed this, I need to do what now? Yeah, okay, I'll get this certificate that I can drive or whatnot, right? Because I want to use your property and for transportation. But that's entirely different.
So I interrupted you.
Oh, no. So that would solve that problem, because I'm on roads too, right? I'm not saying I don't want roads, but I'm on roads in which that are on private land with rules that I give explicit consent to. Not the ones that kind of we have today that's forced on you.
So let's say you want to travel to California.
Yeah.
Okay. So, and all of these different roads are privatized, and they're saying the only way you can drive on my road, which at this point could be the only road there, if they make enough revenue, if they decide that they're going to build all of the roads that go that way, they're saying, okay, well, if you want to drive on my road, you're going to have to give me $1,000 at every toll booth or something.
Right.
And you don't have another choice, right? Because that's the only way for you to drive to California.
And that is contractual.
All right. So that's a good one, right? So this person who puts up a high fee for it will find that no one's going to be using this road because, you know, it's kind of like if you have a community that you set up that you borrowed a lot of money, but you have very intolerable rules, no one's going to move there, you're going to go bankrupt.
Economics do help.
Right, so there's going to be competing markets in there that say, look, I got this better. Actually, all the businesses are going to get together to build this road and put advertisements on there to help pay for it, because it's kind of like when you go to a shopping mall, you don't build for that road trying to go to the food court and all the different t-shirt stores there, right? That's also provided by Segway Security and free Wi-Fi. You don't pay for that. The businesses, they pay that because they want to get from point A to point B, right?
That's also building two roads where you only need one.
Yeah, but also build roads around the mall. They also have space for you to park, right? Businesses build these things. Go to Disneyland. All those things there are roads that they have going all over the place. So it's not so much, you could have one business trying to do that. Horrible business decision, he'll likely go bankrupt and someone will just buy him out when he forecloses and build a better business market process to facilitate travel.
I don't know if I would agree that somebody would buy it out and do something better with it, because at this point, the way that it seems like most of us live our lives is like greedy. We always want more, and therefore...
What's wrong with greed?
I mean, I'm just saying, like, for your example, if you can't afford to do it, you're not going to do it. correct? If the road toll is $1,000, you're not going to do it.
And I'm about that, so.
Yeah, yeah. But the thing about it's not, business owners do not dictate price. Consumers do, right? All these individual choices dictate what the price of that good is going to be. I could say it was going to cost $1,000, but if no one's going to pay that, you're not going to get $1,000, right?
Right.
So it's...
until you're the only one providing.
That's only happens under government, right? Like state grant, Dominion Power is a state granted monopoly.
Right.
Right? Without this government to grant these monopoly privileges, anyone can compete now in the market.
So would you say that...
Lots of competing markets for roads.
Would you say that businesses that come together... Like you said, they would, you know, come together. They have a better idea for roads or something.
Yes.
Would you say that when they come together and they decide this is what we're going to do, that when it gets good and they say, oh, people are going to have to use this. They have to use this to get here. They can up the price if they want. It's like gasoline.
So you could probably do it in the very beginning. We're the first one here, so we're going to charge $20, right? You look at like plasma screen TVs like a couple years ago, like the flat ones cost thousands of dollars. I mean, you think that they wish they could still hold on to that kind of price, right? But market competition starts to come in, and now you can get a better one for $100,
right?
What about
monopolies forming, such as with like just the different resources? Why, when big corporations come together and they're like, hey, well, we can rake the price up if we all come together and raise it together.
Yeah.
What keeps that from happening if there's no government?
Because anyone can compete, though. So that's the problem. So this group of people say, we're going to raise this particular good that a lot of people are vending or selling as well. To like $5 instead of $3. It just takes one person to break that market
one
share.
Person,
it's just like, well, I'm just going to sell it for $4.99.
When you buy that person, give them a deal they can't resist.
All right, so that's even better one. So say like there's five people who offer, right? You buy this guy out for $1 million.
All
right. Right, now there's a scarcity there, all right? So he's going to say, well, in order to buy me out, you're going to have to pay me $10 million. I was like, great, now I have to get a lot of money and loans and secure all that. I was like, great, got him. All right, three more left. It's like, well, even more of a scarcity. Well, $50 million.
That already raises the prices. The scarcity raises the prices.
Right. They don't have to sell because they know now you're troubling and weighing yourself down with a lot of debt that will be difficult for you to pay off.
But if you
$50,000.
If you just sat like this with the three fingers up, there's already a scarcity. So you've already raised the price some. So you're already making more money. And you own those two now. So you're making
No. They raise their prices too. It's like, look, $100 million.
Yeah.
Right? You're not going to survive as a business with so much debt that you're not going to be able to pay back. The last two don't even have to sell, and they just wait till you crumble so they can compete in the market and celebrate at your horrible marketing decisions. And of course, when these last two even say that they're bought, the very next day, someone starts a Kickstarter campaign, bam, now you have a sixth person. You can't buy anyone out because because at any time and place, anyone can now compete. So it's impossible to buy out everybody. Everyone in the whole world has to either be trying to compete in the market for you to say, okay, now nobody. But of course, new people are born all the time and people are entering, and that's impossible. Yeah. You can get maybe a large market share and hopefully do well with that. But you looked at Blockbuster, had a great market share with like video rentals until like something small, some little startup came up with a Redbox and just knocked them out, right?
That's true.
And nobody shed a tear when Blockbuster closed their last door. It's like, you know, nobody has a right to profit. You
are
have
they
to
fully out now?
Yeah, I believe so, yeah. Oh,
actually, I think I've seen one.
One?
One.
A remnant, a relic?
It's probably like a national museum.
You need to take your like little siblings. This is a place where we used to go, and they used to charge us if we were late, and you know, and rewind tapes.
Charges you too, which...
Well, now you have Netflix, and it's like, hey, keep it for a month or whatever. And...
Except that you don't get a lot of good stuff on Netflix, let's be real.
Now they have streaming sites now, right? Hulu.
Well,
that's another payment.
It gets better. Well, I don't pay for any of that stuff. There's a lot of good streaming sites out there. You can watch...
illegally?
Not legally. Streaming.
I have never found a streaming website that was at least worth my time to watch.
Watch cartoononline.com. Great one.
Is it only cartoons, though?
Yes.
Okay, that would be a problem.
What? Rick and Morty. You guys like Rick and Morty?
No.
What do you mean no? You seen it already?
No, I'm sorry. I've seen like one episode.
Okay. Best cartoon show on the planet. I would strongly recommend catching it. Favorite him for him. And the guy actually doesn't like government as well.
Look at that.
Yeah, he's actually. It's a play like on Back to the Future of Morty and Doc, right? So, but a cartoon form. Like, what it would be like in cartoon form. They're actually in the same family together and going on these crazy scientific adventures. And there's an alternate world in which all the Ricks and all these different alternate dimensions were afraid of government, hated it, but they got together and created their own government. And so he's like. you know, what the fuck are you guys doing here? We were supposed to be the rickest rick. We're not, you know, we're always kind of anti-authoritative, and all of a sudden you guys got together because you were scared of the government and created your own kind of government to begin with.
Do you watch Adventure Time?
Adventure Time, yeah. Awesome show. Awesome show.
I heard it's pretty great, too.
How do you tie that with that?
Well, I'm just kidding.
Heroics, right?
I'm probably
the greatest adventure is fighting for freedom.
That's right.
Well, thanks for giving
us absolutely.
It's
been a pleasure.
This guy, he will talk to anybody about anything, and he'll play devil's advocate until you.
Oh, that's good. That's how you sharpen.
Into a hole.
Stop. Let me give you a flyers here, real quick. Send me a message here, and I'll send you guys all the awesome stuff that you guys will just draw on a lot of happiness looking into, and a lot of stuff that I was misled to.
I'm happy. I got joy.
Even more.
I got joy.
For your reading pleasure.
Well, thank you. Hope more people stop and talk to you.
Absolutely. Thank you, guys. Have fun out there
in
Kentucky.
Which one is the library?
The library is this one right here.
Okay, cool. That's
and
probably where I'm
free
headed.
Food over there. I got to stop. That's my next stop
free
right
food.
Now.
All right, thanks.
Take good care, guys.
This episode is brought to you by State of Wake, a podcast show for your daily dose of anarchy and anti-statism. It's a show that's actually run by my good friend Paul Gordon. And if you guys want to hear more anarchy stuff, you know, check his stuff out, stateofwake.com. And thank you so much again, everyone else, for your support. If you guys want to find out how you can also help build this fully armed and operational battle station for freedom, check out my Patreon account to see how you can also help in that endeavor. Every person, though, regardless of the amount, will receive a free copy of my book when it's finished on everything anarchy, and most importantly, a guide on how you too can start your own liberate chapter in spreading anarchy in your city as well. So with that, see you guys at the Virtue Party and stay liberated.
Material world.